Hi everybody, today we have Edwin Rivas, new forward for Las Vegas Lights. My name is Juan Rodas. To start off, Edwin, thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm really happy that you accepted my invitation. I know you probably have things to do and you're very busy as a professional player. And like I said, thank you very much for that. How are you doing today?
Good, I'm good. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to support another, you know, Guatemalan ancestor. So it's good. Everything's good.
Thank you. I appreciate it. To start off, Edwin, how did you start playing soccer? Like, do you remember your first memory even touching the ball? Or were there other family members within your family that started playing? Or were you, like, the first one to start off playing?
So my dad, he used to play. He played for La Gomera and Escuinca. And he never had the opportunity to go pro as far as he wanted to. But I remember Sundays in L.A. going to the games and, you know, being able to touch the ball, seeing him play a little bit. But, sí, me recuerdo tocar la pelota así cuando era niño, pequeñito, como unos 5 años, 6 años, y tocando la pelota, jugando con él. Pero de ese día, pues, no paré de jugar, pues.
Sí, por supuesto. We know that in high school you probably had a very good career and you probably got a lot of offers from colleges, including Northridge. And you scored, I was seeing the stats, you did pretty good for Northridge. Were there any other offers that you got out of high school, or was Northridge your only option?
Well, honestly, I didn't play high school soccer.
Oh, you
did? I played football and basketball throughout my 4 years, and towards my senior year of high school, that's when I got connected to Real SoCal. Cuando me fui a Real SoCal, el entrenador de Northridge era el entrenador. Yes, Terry Davila. Mm-hmm. Y el entrenador de Real SoCal. De la academia de ahí, pues de ahí me fui. Like my senior year of high school, that's when I started getting more serious towards soccer and more, you know,
committed,
and it was more Real SoCal had more organization.
Mm-hmm.
in sense of what I was playing.
Yeah.
Little leagues, like AYSO type of leagues, like low level, not very organized clubs, big clubs like UC, Galaxy, Chivas USA when they were here,
mm-hmm.
Arsenal when they were here, Chelsea, LFC,
wow.
Like those teams. But as I got really focused on that, then that's when I started really
progressing
to soccer. That's when I felt even more passion of it, more competitive,
mm-hmm.
In the sense of before. Before it was just, I love the game, you know, my dad put me in it, I love having fun, this and that, but then it became more, you know, it became more organized and I understood it in a way, way different world.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
It became even way more fun, way more enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's how I started.
So, obviously, after Northridge, you get selected by Toronto FC. That must have been, you know, an amazing feeling. And eventually, you sign with Toronto FC, the second team. How, you know, tell us about your experience. How were you feeling? Were you, obviously, you probably were excited. Describe us what was going through your mind.
Man, it was unexpected because I think I was going to get drafted. I knew some teams were interested, but I didn't think I was going to get drafted. So but when I heard, because I wasn't looking at the draft or anything. But when I turned it on, like something told me that just to turn it on and mm-hmm. see who I know that, who I played against,
yeah.
Might have drafted.
Mm-hmm.
Then I get a call from my agent saying, hey, you about to get drafted. And I seen it, and I didn't have no words. Like, I was just super, like, I was surprised. Mm-hmm. I was happy. You know, when something like that happens in your life, when something that's really, you've been digging to work for every day of your life, every day, and since you started from the end, mm-hmm. that goal, then, you know, you feel great. You feel a good feeling inside. Something you can't take away from a person.
For sure. And talk to us about your experience with Toronto FC.
Toronto was a great experience. Obviously, it's another level.
Mm-hmm.
The city was lovely. It was great. The team was great. The coaching staff was great. I mean, everything was, you know, a first-time look for me at that level. So as my experience went on throughout the year, and just everything was very new. It was not something I, you know, I expected or read into it. I just took it day by day and control what I was able to control. And that was just my game and whatever I can do at my best.
Mm-hmm.
But it was great. It was a great experience. Seeing Josie, Altidore, Michael Bradley, Jovinko, you know, Justin Moore, who's been called up in the national team. Just, it was great. It was, mm-hmm. it was good seeing him.
For sure. That's must have been a wonderful experience.
Oh, definitely. And seeing the guys that come up from the second team to mm-hmm. MLS teams, like Mark Anthony Cave yeah. that plays for LAFC,
yeah.
Raheem Edwards that played for Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
He came up through that system, and it's good to see that there's progress, and there's sure. not, you know, there's not just staying stuck in one position. That mm-hmm. you know, there is opportunities out there that people should really look into and take advantage of.
For sure, for sure. And obviously, after Toronto FC, from the latest thing that I saw was you were playing with Cal United FC and also LA Wolves. Talk to us about how those offers came about and how was your experience overall playing for both those teams?
It was good. It was, you know, it's not, every level has a level. Mm-hmm. So with playing with Wolves, obviously it was, you know, it was a more humbling experience that, you know, nothing's easy. So,
for sure.
You know, in order to even keep climbing that ladder, you know, there's bumps on the road. It's never a straight line. The, mm-hmm. the road is great for anybody. If it was that, then it'll be easy for everybody.
Yeah.
So, but it was great because in the sense of it brought more IQ, more, a little bit more relaxation, more, not saying that the level is low, but like, you see what you see, and that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it was good. LA Wolves was good. Once the team changed to Cal United, the people was great. Ownership was great. Eric Ronaldo was the coach at the time there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just a great experience because I got to play with different players. For I got sure. to play with Cardoso.
Mm-hmm.
And ex players, professional players that have been in the league, that's been in the same situation I am, and you know, it's good to see that they're still hungry. So mm-hmm. in those terms, I do consider that experience a great one.
For sure. As other players, I think probably Brian De La Fuente too, correct?
Yeah. He was there, Brian De La Fuente, Jesus Gonzalez.
There was a left back from Columbus Crew?
He was there at Columbus Crew. He was in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Eric had the team there. Yeah, there's a lot of guys that, you know, NASL players
uh-huh.
with just great talent.
For sure. And now, moving forward, you know, fortunately, you have signed with Las Vegas Lights, also under Eric Winalda. I was reading recently, he spoke very good about you. He said that you have very good left foot. You're very fast. You know, he spoke great things about you. And talk to us about your expectations for this new this new season upcoming for Las Vegas Lights, who I think their second season. And I think you're going to be the second Guatemalan playing for them too. If you didn't know, Nicolás Samayoa played for them on loan last year from New England Revolution. But yeah, tell us something about your expectations for the new season under Eric Winalda, who knows you very well.
Expectations are good to have. Mm-hmm. It keeps you on your toes.
For sure.
Very high for yourself, even for the team. But individually, I think expectations for me are always high. But as a player, I can't let that control me. Mm-hmm. And I can only be in the present. Yeah. And I just expect for myself to do the best I can be. Be the best I can be and do the best I can do for the team,
mm-hmm.
included. So, and yeah, I mean, everyone has big expectations for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, doing well and putting myself back on the map, at least to like people that, you know, didn't think I was gonna able to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, you know, I don't do it for them. I do it for, you know, the higher power and myself. So,
exactly.
Family, of course.
Yeah.
That's all I'm concerned about.
And as a striker, Edwin, are you like the type of striker that you set a goal maybe saying, like, I need to score 15 goals this season? Or are you just the type of player that you go, you know, game by game, and if you score, you're happy, or obviously as anybody would with the 3 points?
Man, everyone loves to score. Yeah. Everyone loves to score. And I'm the type of player now that, you know, before I've always had the expectation to score these amount.
Yeah.
But as I'm not that no more. I'm more of a game by day, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to, you know, whip that ball in, cross it. I love that assist feeling because mm-hmm. it feels cool to me.
Yeah.
So I think, like, you know, scoring, yeah, that's great. But assists, it's even greater for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's more than myself.
Yeah.
More than I. It's a team thing, and
mm-hmm.
you know, glorifying someone else or even, you know, put someone else in a position where they're able to win too.
Mm-hmm.
It's bigger than one goal for me.
For sure. And do you have also any rituals? Like, do you pray before a game? Do you, like, step with your left on the pitch? Do you listen to a type of music? Do you have anything, any type of ritual?
Rituals? I mean, I pray every day.
Mm-hmm.
So, before practice, before I get on the pitch, before I touch the grass.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, no, not really.
Not really.
I try not to psych myself up with that stuff.
Yeah.
God is in control of everything, so I mean, there's no such thing as good luck or bad luck for me.
For sure. And obviously, from you going from Toronto FC to Cal United, and now going back to Las Vegas, what other leagues would you want to play in, and why? Possibly back to the MLS, maybe to Guatemala. What league would you that intrigues you and that you want to play in, and why?
Man, right now, I'm in the present. Just, you know, kill it here with Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to light on my name to be recognized. To be considered, at least.
Mm-hmm.
MLS would be the ideal. Like, you know, that would be a good stepping stone.
For sure.
Great stepping stone. USL is a great stepping stone already.
Mm-hmm.
Where I want to get.
Yeah.
To the next level. I mean, 27, I know that door is closing, but, you know, that's not going to prevent me from trying to get there.
Exactly.
So, if it's Guatemala, it's Guatemala. If it's MLS, it's MLS. They're both in a great category.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, the expectation is there. The ambition is there. So I think, you know, wherever I land is where I'll be supposed to be doing.
For sure, for sure. And obviously, as a little kid, you know, when you don't know what you're going to be up when you grow up, who was your, probably like your favorite player that you looked up to, you know, from, I don't know if you started off as a striker as a little kid, and if you did, who was the, probably like your favorite player that you looked up to and that you wanted to be like?
Oh, man. I was a striker, and I used to look at Ronaldo Lima.
Mm-hmm.
The R9, the true 9.
Yeah, Brasileño.
Brasileño.
Yeah.
Man, dude, I was watching him a lot, and I used to imitate his haircuts.
You did?
I used to have the little patch here, so yeah, yeah. It was, yeah, that was my favorite player on the pitch.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that he did on the pitch was, man, it was amazing for me. It was like I was always trying to imitate him in the games.
Mm-hmm.
Every move I make, every shot I make, I would try to do what he did. So, mm-hmm. I'll say that would be my all-time favorite player.
Okay, interesting, interesting. Not a bad player to look up to at all. As a coach, because you probably had many coaches throughout your career so far, who has been probably the best coach that you've had, and what has been probably the best, you know, advice that he has given you?
Yeah, I've come across a lot of coaches. You know, I can't say one or the other was, you know, my best coach or the best coach I've had.
Mm-hmm.
Every coach has a different philosophy. Every coach brings a different energy.
Mm-hmm.
And not every coach is the same. So I think every coach I went and played for brought something that affected me in a positive way.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I appreciate every coach I had, actually, because, you know, without their knowledge and their wisdom, I probably wouldn't have known.
Mm-hmm.
So, for me to sit here and say, this is my favorite coach, I don't think I have a favorite coach. I think every coach brought some wisdom into me to make me a better player, to make me the player I am now.
Mm-hmm.
I think all the coaches I've had and played for, they were great. So, I don't have no preference in who I like to play for or what they play. It taught me something different every time. So, I was able to play different systems whenever I went to the next coach or the next.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
For sure. And obviously, after you train or after you're in probably a game, what do you like to do on your free time? Do you have a family? Do you just try to chill with friends? Like, what do you do outside of soccer? Because I'm pretty sure after a game or training, you know, you don't want to probably just soccer. You know, you're a human being and you have a life, you know?
Definitely. You know, hang out with friends, family, hang out with a lot of my nieces and nephews and cousins, and yeah, mostly family.
Mm-hmm.
But friends as well, like, you know, we go out to eat, you know, take soccer away from us for a little bit.
For sure.
Be open-minded at least to other things. If it's movies, if it's bowling, you know, things in that nature.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, try to get away from soccer a little bit. It doesn't have to be a job.
Yeah, yeah.
Get a job. It has to be fun every day, so.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And I think if I'm not mistaken, was it 2015 or 2016 that you got called up to Guatemala? And I wanted to go more in depth. How did they contact you? I think Walter Claveri probably contacted you. How was that situation? Were you happy? Were you ambitious to play for Guatemala? Or like, did you even think about playing for Guatemala when you did get called up?
Oh, man. When I got called up, it was in 2016. I went through this soccer academy, a Guatemalan soccer academy that was based out in LA, and they contacted Claudia, and, you know, made it happen. Went out there, it was great. Like, representing the country, I mean, not a lot of people can say they did that. Yeah. I've done. I mean, I haven't really got a cap. I haven't got a cap with Guatemala, played an official game with them, and you know, that's the next goal. So hopefully this door opens up that door, but you know, it's not my decision. I'll do my best to get there, but you know, at the end of the day, I gotta do what I gotta do now. Mm-hmm. But the feeling was great. I mean, being there next to Pescadito, that's been a hero to a lot of players out there, a lot of people out there for that country, and he's done so much. You know, all I can do is just watch and learn. Mm-hmm. And it was great. It was good seeing the environment there. You know, because I was also called up to the U-20s. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when they made it to the World Cup, when they defeated U.S. to make it to go to the World Cup.
So you played with Moises Hernandez.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah, I bet. I was there. I was in the top 20. But I didn't travel with them. Mm-hmm. But that was when Almeida was there.
Yeah, Almeida. Yep.
And he saw me play, so you know that's how it all started. But it was great. I mean, it was great to think that, you know, a little kid from LA is gonna represent Guatemala, or even to even dream that big. It's not. There's no such thing. So mm-hmm. It was one of those moments again where, you know, you can't take away from anybody.
For sure. And let's say, because Guatemala is playing, I think, next month, I guess, Honduras, I think Costa Rica and Paraguay in March. If you do get called up, I don't know if anytime soon, what's your response to Clarity? Or, like, do you guys even still talk?
No. I don't have no connection with him in terms of talking back. No. The last time I seen him was the last time I was called up. Mm-hmm. That was the last time was in at the StubHub when we played Armenia. Mm-hmm. That was the last time I saw him, spoke to him, or anything. But yeah, if I do get called up, you know, obviously I would love to. You know, that's something that I wouldn't even say no to, because mm-hmm. Representing the country where your parents are from and trying to, you know, do it for the people, then that's something great.
Mm-hmm. And also recently we have seen many Guatemalan players that have played outside of Guatemala, but to me, unfortunately, they're coming back. Like Nicolas Samayoa, who was playing for New England, came back in San Comunicaciones. Pablo Aguilar, who was in the play for Rio Grande Toros, signed with Antigua. Mismo Chincota, who was playing in Germany, signed with Guastatoya, Aparicio, and others as well. What do you think that us Guatemalan players are not doing well outside of Guatemala, which then brings us back to them playing in Guatemala? Because honestly, we need more players to build up our national team. We have to export more players outside. You know, just give us your input on that.
I mean, I can only speak for myself, mm-hmm. in terms of where I want to play.
Yeah.
And, you know, if they decide to go back to Guatemala and, you know, play in the league there, then, you know, they probably have a purpose to that. Mm-hmm. My purpose is to be great here where I'm at. Mm-hmm. Accomplishments, get to my goals, and you know, there's no right or wrong on what they're doing. Mm-hmm. You know, it could be situational stuff, but in order for us, as you know, Guatemala as a country, and to succeed, I mean, it all is gonna fall in place. I mean, there's no bad player. There's no, you know, It's all it will all come. I mean, I think we have great players. I think there's players out there that are all getting overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
I get even looked at, and you know, some players need to get their opportunity.
For sure,
there can be the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Not just one, but all, like, you know, a couple.
Yeah.
And going, I think those players that have gone, going back to Guatemala and playing there, I mean, yeah, they bring even better opportunities. You know, they bring experience, they bring knowledge, you know, from their experiences in, whether it's in Germany, MLS, or where they're, wherever they're at,
mm-hmm.
they bring different. They bring a little sauce to the, you know, back to Guatemala.
For sure.
To spread, you mm-hmm. know. So, you know, it's great for us. It's great for, you know, the Guatemalan league.
Mm-hmm.
Get that and learn from. And,
sure.
you know, kids will be able to see that and imitate that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think it's a good thing.
Most definitely. And obviously throughout your long career that you've had so far, who has been like the best player that you've played against or even had as a teammate? Best player overall that you've had the chance to be with or against?
Oh, man. I think playing against, you know, MLS players.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not just one player. I think playing against MLS players, playing with MLS players, it's always a great opportunity. You know, playing against Jovinko is like one of the first players that I've played against. That's from like Italy, played in the national team. Just like, you know, that's
mm-hmm.
you know, that's mind blowing.
For sure.
Because you see a different level, you see a different game.
Mm-hmm.
But everyone I come across is different.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they bring something different I learn from. So it's like, it's good to see that not everything you see is the same.
For sure.
Come against is going to be the same.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of even changes up your game, and if you want to see it that way, so it makes you better. But yeah, I mean, to be specific, if it's one player, I can't really say one player. I think everyone that I've come across and went up against or played with,
mm-hmm.
they brought a different taste to the game.
For sure. For sure. Also, talking about related to soccer, obviously, as a forward, who has been the number one or possibly the hardest defender that you've come across during a game?
Man, I can't really come up with the name
mm-hmm.
because. I'll say, like, once I come across a fast player like me, you know, it gets kind of tricky.
Yeah.
You got to dip a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I've come across a lot of those. For me, those, you know, those are tricky for me. But, everyone's different. Every defender I come across,
mm-hmm.
it's different. And I got to find a way.
For sure.
If way is the only way, then that's what I gotta do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I gotta beat my opposition all the mm-hmm. time.
Most definitely. Also, what has been the most toughest game in your career? The most hardest game that you've came across?
Most toughest game. I remember one of the toughest games for me was. When we went in college, it was in college. It was one of the. We were down, not even. We were playing against UC Davis for the championship.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they scored, we scored, and then one of our forwards scored. And we couldn't get the chances we wanted, but it was a hell of a game, but we came out with the win.
With the victory.
We were league champs and everything. So that's when we went to NCAA tournament, but That was one of the toughest.
That's nice. And also, going back to Las Vegas, tell us about, you know, your first few trainings that you've had with the team. Talk to us about the environment, your teammates. Are there any crazy teammates so far? Or are there, you know, any shy ones? Talk to us about your experience in Las Vegas so far.
Vegas has been great so far. You know, totally what I expected. You know, it was gonna be high level, a lot of competition. You know, at the end of the day, you want to do what's best for yourself. You want to win a spot in the team. And every day you go out to practice, you know, it's a grudge match. So, you know, every day it's being tested. You're getting looked at. And it's great. It's a great environment in terms of the players. Like, everyone's at a level where, you know, they can be in the MLS right now. Like, no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
Doubt about it. They bring a high level of soccer, of knowledge, tactical, technical, whatever you want to call it. But it's great. It's a good competitive spirit out there. Training, you know, we're in double days right now, so, you know, it's preseason. That's what's expected. The body will break down, so everything from here is more in a level where you have to be professional in terms of taking care of your body. You got to know what to eat. You know, you got to get treatment if you need it. Do the right things for your body so you can be able to compete at a level where, you know, it's not always relaxed. And, you know, so it's good. The experience here so far is great. I think it's, you know, it's good for all of us that are here now.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Edwin, for your time. I really appreciate your, like I said, for your time. And because you're a professional player, you're probably busy. I wish you the best of luck this season with Las Vegas Lights. Hopefully you score bangers on all the oppositions, you know, and hopefully I'll meet you soon in person. And God bless, and thank you so much for your time.
Definitely. Thank you, man. Appreciate you.
Thank you. Everybody, for looking at my video. If y'all liked it, please like and subscribe. I will be releasing more content soon. But like I said, if you guys could speak your word about me to your friends, colleagues, parents, cousins, that would be grateful. Thank you so much. See you next time.